Welcome to English class. So today we will discuss the poem Lines Written in Early Spring by William Wordsworth. So William Wordsworth is a poet of nature. So in this poem, in the beginning, you can see a picture is given. Look at the picture closely. What do you see there? Okay. See, two parts are given there. The first part, what do you see? You see a beautiful scenery. You can see rivers, mountain, trees, flowers, birds, and all these things together make this nature very beautiful to see. But what about the second part of that picture? Okay, I think that is to show human activities. What are they doing? What are we humans doing? We are, or humans are, destroying nature for their selfish needs. So it is told that man is trying to find happiness. But for that, what he does is he destroys nature. What should we actually do? As we have seen in the beginning of this unit, the theme of the unit, we should live in harmony with the nature. So in this poem also such an idea is given. Here the poet says that, see, all the other living organisms of this world, of this nature, are living happily, but man, they are destroying nature, and they are the only beings doing harm to nature. So we will see, we will come to the poem and we will see what are the ideas given here. The first stanza: I heard a thousand blended notes while in a grove I sat reclined, in that sweet mood when pleasant thoughts bring sad thoughts to the mind. So the poet says that he was very happy. Where was he? In a grove, it is mentioned. That means in a small forest. Why was he, or how was he enjoying his life there? It is mentioned in order to show that he was relaxing, enjoying. It is told that he was sitting reclined, sitting in a relaxed mood in a forest. What did he listen to? It is mentioned a thousand blended notes. What may be the thousand blended notes referred here? Okay, no doubt. Refers to the sound of nature. What are the normal sounds that we can listen from nature? The sound of birds, the sound of trees, the sound of waterfalls, sound of wind. Okay, we know that whenever we listen to nature, there will be some sounds we can listen to. So, while the poet was sitting there in a relaxed mood, he was enjoying his life. And in order to show his mood, the third line says, in that sweet mood when pleasant thoughts bring sad thoughts to the mind. He was sitting with the pleasant thoughts. He was very happy. But suddenly, there came some sad thoughts. He became sad. Okay, and what was the reason for that sadness? That is mentioned in the next stanza. Okay, to listen to the next stanza. To her fair works did nature link the human soul that through me ran, and much it grieved my heart to think what man has made of me. So the reason for his sadness is mentioned. So what is nature trying to do? What is nature trying to do? Nature is trying to link humans also to nature. What's the meaning of that? While we think of nature, birds are there, animals are there, trees are there, and also no doubt humans are also there. All these living organisms together form nature. That means man also is part of nature. Man cannot stand separate. So nature is trying to link humans also to nature. Then, and much it grieved my heart to think what man has made of me. So why did the poet become sad? Grieved. Grieved means became sad. When did the poet become sad? While the poet thought about human activities, what man has made of man. So what may be the things that man has made to man? Okay, there we have to think of the destructive human activities. Can you mention some of the human activities destructive? Okay, deforestation or polluting the environment, throwing waste materials to the land and to the water bodies and causing pollution to the air, and then maybe referring to killing each other, maybe in the form of a war, maybe terrorist attacks, killing each other, killing his own fellow beings. So all the other living organisms are trying to live in harmony with nature, but only man is doing against it. Man is killing his own fellow beings. So what will happen? What will happen? After a certain years, life will become impossible in this world. So only humans are doing such an activity. That is why the poet says that he became very sad while he thought of human activities. Then, through primrose tufts in their green bower, the periwinkle trailed its wreaths, and it's my faith that every flower enjoys the air it breathes. Then the poet is looking around to nature to see what is their response or what they are doing. So in this stanza, the poet refers to flowers, and two flowers are specified there. Which are the flowers? Primrose and periwinkle. Okay, that just represents two flowers. That simply we can say that the poet was looking into the nature and watching the response or the deeds of the other living organisms. And what about the flowers? The flowers are growing in abundance. They are growing in bunch, and they are making others happy. And the flowers are also enjoying its life. That's what the poet feels. It is mentioned, and it is my faith that every flower enjoys the air it breathes. The flowers are also enjoying life here. Okay, and then next the poet looked around and saw birds. So the birds around me hopped and played, their thoughts I cannot measure. But the least motion which they made, it seemed a thrill of pleasure. So after the flowers, the poet looked into the birds. And what were they doing? They were playing and jumping around. So actually the poet cannot measure the thoughts of the birds. But from their motion, from their movements, the poet understood that they are also enjoying their life. It seemed a thrill of pleasure. For them also, life is pleasurable and enjoyable. And next, the poet looked into the trees, the small buds there. The budding twigs spread out their fan to catch the breezy air. And I must think, do all I can, that there was pleasure there. The budding twigs, the small branches of the trees, the leaves, what do? They spread out their fans. The branches spread out their fans, spread out their leaves to catch the breezy air, to catch the wind. So the poet feels that the wind also is enjoying its life there. So the flowers are enjoying its life, the birds are enjoying life, even the trees, even the branches of the trees are also enjoying life, and they are spreading happiness to others. But what about man? Man is destroying nature. Man is doing harm to his own fellow beings. So while he thought of these human activities, he became sad. Then, if this belief from heaven be sent, if such be nature's holy plan, have I not reason to lament what man has made of me? If this belief from heaven be sent, what is the belief that is sent from heaven? What is nature's holy plan? Okay, that holy plan shows that, see, nature wants to make every creations of nature happy. Or nature is trying to spread happiness to all its creations. And this is a belief sent from heaven. We have to do what we can. We have to do what we can to make others happy. And if we have to find real happiness, we should look into nature. Then, have I not reason to lament what man has made of man? If a person understands nature's holy plan, that is, to spread happiness to its beings, the poet says that he has reasons to lament because he knows human activities. He knows that only humans are destroying nature. Only humans are causing harm to his own fellow beings. So, while he thought of these human activities, he became sad. So, the theme of the poem is that while we live in this world, while we live in this nature, we should try to find happiness from nature. We should do what we can to spread happiness to our fellow beings. We should not destroy nature. We should not harm our fellow beings. Okay, that's the idea of the poem. So, what you have to do is to read it carefully, read it many times. Then, coming back to the poem, we have to discuss the poetic devices also. Okay, last year also we have discussed poetic devices of poem, and in this poem also we will come to, because I think there is nothing new. All the poetic devices we have discussed last year. Then we know that in the case of all the poem, the first poetic device that we mainly discuss is rhyme scheme. Okay, so how do we find out the rhyme scheme? We look at the last two words of each line, and according to the sound, we number it using English alphabet, small letter, A, B, C, etc. Okay, if it is like this, what's the first word of the first, what's the last word of the first line? Notes. Okay, so as it is the first sound, we mark it with the small letter A. Now come to the second word, reclined. No similarity with the sound, notes, a new sound. So with the second letter B, so A, B. Then coming to the third word, thoughts. So thoughts and notes similar, that last sound, sir sound similar to. So this also will be A. Then the fourth word is mind, reclined mind. So last bending sound, the sound. So here also B. So what's the rhyme scheme? A, B, A, B. That's the rhyme scheme of the stanza. And in the other stanzas also, the same rhyme scheme is followed. That is A, B, A, B. Okay, we have learned it. That means you have to look at the last two words of each line, and the first sound should be marked with A. The second sound, if it's a new sound, should be marked with B. And whenever a sound is repeated, the same letter should be marked. That's why notes and thoughts be marked with A, reclaimed and mind marked with B. So rhyme scheme of the poem is, of the stanza is A, B, A, B. Okay, then listen to this line. I heard a thousand blended notes. I heard a thousand blended notes. What's the feel that we get while we read this line? We get an auditory feel. That means we get a feel that we listen to these sounds. So while we think of the image, which is that image, auditory, something that is related to sound, A-U-D-I-T-O, or auditory. So that's an example of auditory image. The same time, I heard a thousand blended notes is an example for hyperbole. H-Y-P-E-R-B-O-L-E. H-Y-P-E-R-B-O-L-E. അല്ലെ ഹൈപ്പർബോൾ. വാട്ട് ഈസ് ഹൈപ്പർബോൾ? ദാറ്റ് മീൻസ് എക്സാജറേറ്റഡ് സെയിങ്. Exaggerated saying. So listen to this sound. I heard 1,000 bullet notes. So we know that the poet listened to many sounds from nature, sound of birds, sound of trees, maybe sound of rivers, and so on. So if you count, will it be 1,000? No, not 1,000. Listen to many sounds. So here 1,000. The use of this word 1,000 is an exaggeration. So that exaggerated saying is called a hyperbole. Will you listen to the word hyperbole? hyperbole. So in the first line, is an example for hyperbole. Same time, first line is an example for auditory image. Then coming to the second stanza, see. To her fair works did nature link the human soul that through me ran. To her, what is this her referred to here? Her refers to nature. What does it mean? Nature is considered as a person. Okay, nature is considered as a woman. So what's the poetic device used here? Personification. Okay, personification is there. What is personification? Not a human, anything, maybe a living or non-living thing, considered like a person, that is personification. So in this poem, there are three examples for personification. One is, to her fair works did nature link. And then the second, next stanza, every flower enjoys the air it breathes. Enjoying something, actually that is done by, or that's a human activity, and we know that a flower cannot enjoy the air and okay. So here also the poet considers flower or a human attribute is given. That means it is told that flower is enjoying is an activity done by human. So that is also an example for personification. And then the next part, see, but the least motion which they made it seemed a thrill of next one. The budding twigs spread out their fan to catch the breezy air. Can a branch, can leaves catch air? No, catching something, that also is a human activity. So three examples for personification. Which are they? First one, to her fair works did nature link. So her, the use of her, nature is considered like a woman. And in the next one, see, the flower enjoys the air it breathes, personification. And here, the budding twigs spread out their fan to catch the breezy air. Then another poetic device that you have learned, see this line, what man has made of man. See this line, what's the specialty of this line? See the word man, which is the first sound, m sound, made. Again, mo sound. Again, the word man, mo sound. So what happens here in the case of these three words, man, made, and man? The first sound, mo sound, is repeated. Mo sound is repeated. So the poetic device is alliteration. Okay, alliteration. Man, made, man. So the sound, mo, repeated. And likewise, see this line, and it is my faith that every flower. Can you find out any words that begin with the same sound? Okay, faith and flower. Faith, the first sound. Flower also, first sound. So this also is an example for alliteration. Okay, then there are a number of examples for visual images, something that we see. Like so many are there, birds, this primrose, periwinkle, flower, then what we say in the first part also, as we have seen, a groove. Okay, that means visual image means while we read through some of the words, we get a feel that we see something in front of us. So what we have discussed here, see, that is given in activity 2. to find out the examples for personification. This is the word personification. We discussed the three examples. Write, find it, go through it once more and write it down here. Then imagery, like visual imageries are there. Then we saw that auditory image is there, listening to sound and all. Alliteration, we have discussed what is alliteration, find out and write down the examples. Then rhymes. Okay. And then the activity you have to complete in this poem is write an appreciation of the poem. How to write an appreciation, that also you have learned last year. First thing, to write down the name of the poem and the poet. So, Lines Written in Early Spring is a poem written by William Wordsworth. Next one, the main theme of the poem. And then the brief summary of the poem you have to write. And then you have to make a comment on the poetic devices used there. Okay, we have discussed the poetic devices. You have to say that the poet has used a number of poetic devices very effectively in this poem. There are a number of examples for personification. You can mention. Likewise, you have to make comment on all the poetic devices. And then last, if it is needed, you can make a personal comment about the poem. How do you feel about the poem? Whether it's a good poem, simple, and what about the theme? What do you feel about the theme? And you can make a personal comment as well. You have to write a critical appreciation of the poem in your notebook. Okay, and read it many times. Okay, we'll stop for today. Make sure that you write it in your notebooks.